Hi, everybody. Welcome back. For those of you who have been come to the earlier programs, and everybody else, welcome as well. It's very nice to see you here. I'm Rene Morales. I'm a curator here at the museum. And once again, some of you have already heard this a few times, but just wanted to give you the context of this program. We are sitting in a structure that was proposed by Marjetica Potrč, who's here with us today. Who conceived of this exhibition, The School of the Forest, which is based on a real initiative that was created in the Amazon, in Acre, in a very remote region, that involved bringing together forest communities from that region with Western theorists and scientists, and for the purpose of exchanging knowledge on equal terms, on an equal basis. So, in a way, this is kind of a symbolic extension of this School of the Forest. And as part of the project, besides building this installation, we've invited a series of speakers to come between now and the end of the show, in the middle of October, to give a talk in the auditorium on Thursday nights, followed by a seminar format program like the one that we're about to do today. So today we have with us the esteemed Dr. Elizabeth Povinelli, who is the Franz Boas Professor of Anthropology at Columbia University. And she also has a parallel practice as an experimental filmmaker with a collective that she is a part of called the Karrabing in Australia. So we're going to hear all about that today and hopefully see some of the film work that this remarkable collective has been generating. So. Without further ado.
Thank you, sorry. Fabulous, I'm hoping what we can do today is have a engagement with a concept that has a common sense referent in places like Indigenous Australia, but also in places like the Amazon, and certainly in Native North and South America. The term is a term that I developed to contrast with another term that many of you guys will know, hopefully, and if not, we'll quickly go over it. But the conceptual force and meaning of the term, and I'll talk about what it is in a second, really emerges out of the kinds of conversations that I think this structure in Acre means to facilitate. That is, although the members of the Karrabing and I really grew up together, so I was 20 when I first went, and other members were everywhere from, like, if they had been born, 7 to about 18. It's a concept that tries to think about power from the position of Indigenous and Native people, okay? The concept is what I is either geonto power, also geontology, and the concept means to indicate and characterize a form of governance that sits behind and makes, in some ways, common sense, a form of power that we thought we've been in for quite a while. So does everyone know what biopolitics or biopower is? It's a biopolitics and biopower, very, very quickly, is a theoretical term of art developed by this French theorist, Michel Foucault, that argues within, and I, liberal spaces, what I would call late liberalism, anyways, the governance of people doesn't work by this idea of the people and their collective will, right? Let the people decide, but rather it works through the idea of population, and more specifically, by making populations live better, live more productively, thrive. And those who refuse to live more productively, live better, and thrive under capital, it does not bother to kill. It simply lets them die. Right? So he contrasted, this is all Michel Foucault, he contrasted this biopower, power through life, right, to an older form of power, which he called sovereign power, that supposedly governed in a different way. That is, rather than make you live better, be more productive, you know, get on the gym, be healthy, make yourself something that is vital and lives and provides force to the economy. Instead, in sovereign power, and then if you refuse to, well, you know, you can just starve, die, live in places that have been abandoned. And he contrasted that to sovereign power, which he said had existed in Europe in the Age of Kings. And that form of power worked not by making you live and letting you die, said Foucault, but rather by letting you live and killing you. That is, you knew who was in control, who had power, by the magical thumb. That person, or that agency that could make you die, was the one that had sovereign power. Okay, so he differentiated forms of power, especially in Europe, between those forms of power that work by having the power to kill you or let you live, and this new kind of power, biopower, that made you live better, which was what capital needed, right? Both of them, however, depend on, and we see this in this moment, depend on the uniqueness of this thing called life. That is, those kinds of existences that can be born, grow, have the capacity to reproduce, whether they do or not. For instance, I didn't, but I'm still a life form, supposedly. And then suffer the drama of dying, right? So theories of precarity, vulnerability in critical theory today all depend on this drama of this thing we call life. That kind of thing that can be born and thus suffer the tragedy of death or finitude, right? Other things, they don't suffer that. This suffered the drama, right? Yeah. But rather than simply those things that are alive and then remain in death, the dominant way in which both the natural sciences, our understandings of power, critical theory itself has been organized is to contrast those things that are life or were life, for this instance, this chair, and those things that were never alive, that is, non-life, geology, right? Meteorology, rocks, for instance, both from Aristotelian philosophy up to the modern distinction between geology and biology, rocks are considered to come into this world fully actualized, right? They don't have the potential to be at something other than they're not, unless some other agency comes in and changes them, right? So I can take a rock formation if I'm a capitalist miner and I say, hey, look, manganese. Through various kinds of processes, I can turn this into something else. Now, the rock, though, supposedly, in this way of thinking, does not have an internal capacity, the way in which an acorn has the internal potential to become an oak tree. See that? And that common sense distinction between those things that have or had life and those things that don't. They don't have the drama. Has organized our common sense understandings of subjectivity, agency, politics, right? The demos, democracy, depends on the voicing of things that have the potential to change. Geontopower, or geontology, that is, beings, geos, or if you want, non-life being, is, in the way I understand it, a form of power that tries to not work through letting you live or letting you, making you live or letting you die, nor through my ability to kill you or let you live, but rather by keeping in place the common sense, absolutely undeniable difference between a rock and a cell. The cell can be born, it can die, and thus, and it also has a certain kind of ethics, because it can have a good death or a bad death, depending on how it bursts. This form of power is the form of power that is revealing itself to us now with the Anthropocene, right? Why? Because now and when I say us, I apologize. I mean those of you who haven't experienced yourself being governed by this, but rather simply say, yeah, well, so what? There's rocks and there's cells. What's the point here? Everybody knows that. Everybody treats a rock differently than life, even in a post-human, which we say, okay, well, not just humans, but other kind of animals. Oh, it's okay. Oh, yeah. Remember Whole Earth, Gaia? You guys have been talking about this? One of the things that the Earth rise and the Earth set, the image that was broadcast off the dark side of the moon and that gave rise to the concept of Gaia through Lovelock and everything, and thus was basis of how we think about things like the carbon cycle, which is the basis of how we think about climate change, which leads to the concept of the Anthropocene. Okay. Gaia, as the background, in the background, pressing into these concepts, their development and then their spread, has taught us who have never been governed or did not experience ourselves being governed by geontopolitics, teaches us that the difference between non-life and life, that is, the geological nature of the Earth and the biological nature of the Earth, perhaps mediated, perhaps in a separate kind of vector. The difference between geology, biology, meteorology is a difference that makes no difference. The breathing planet, the carbon cycle, does not differentiate. It needs, as internal to itself, biotic, geologic, meteorologic phenomena. It cannot breathe without all of them being internal to the other. So you can make the difference as much as you want, but it's a difference that ultimately makes no difference if you want to stay in existence. So suddenly we have a proliferation of all kinds of new natural sciences, say biogeology, and et cetera. The question is twofold, And then we're going to maybe take a, maybe talk a little bit and take a look at a movie. On the one hand, if this is the case, that is, well, wait a minute, is, what is the, we've, and I should say, we've built our ethics, we've built our political systems on the basis of an absolute distinction between life and non-life. And then within life, on a hierarchy of forms of life, right? And so post-humanism is all about trying to break down the hierarchy within the domain of life. Well, what about chimps, and what about dogs, and what about amoebas, and what about, right? So in the Amazon, like all life has thought. This is my colleague Edward Cohen. Trees have thought, et cetera, right? So how do we, but what happens when we break down the difference, the ethical difference, the practical difference, the political difference between geology and biology? How do you have capital? What kind of capitalism? How do you think about participation in the demos, in democracies, right? How do you do this? That's one hand, that's what a lot of people are thinking about. But a second issue, the one I want to talk a little bit more today, is whether or not this is new. Is gerontopower new? Is it something that we're just discovering? Has it supplanted biopolitics, for those of you who understand or know or know what Foucault was saying? We can talk about it more if you want to. And there, I think we have to remember that all concepts, and here we return to the schoolhouse, all concepts have a, if you want, a territorial condition. I didn't say origin, condition. And if you, in a socio-territorial condition, and again, I'm usually, it's like, okay, the difference, it makes no difference, but the full expression of an implotment. So if you were in the Amazon in this house, among some people whose world I know somewhat, the division between the human as a interpretive creature and a tree would be a difference that made no difference. But if you were being governed in the colonial period, it would be the difference that separated you in the civilizational order. We know that, right? That's an old saying. We totally know that. Gerontology or gerontopower works in the same way, but in some ways in a, has worked in a more, oh, I won't say that, in the territory I'm talking about, in equally at least profound way. That is, in Australia, where I have lived and worked for, I guess 31 years, with, you know, with people that, that you saw in the film or you're seeing in the film. The fundamental governing mechanism was not through biopower, making live better or letting die. You could interpret it that way. You could say, well, entire indigenous populations are still allowed to just rot away. And indeed, their life expectancy, all the typical bio metrics are horrendous. But the governing works not fundamentally through that, but through gerontopolitics, that is, through the demand, first the exoticization and civilization through this, the fact that, oh my God, these people think rocks can hear, that rocks have intentionality, that rocks interpret, right? So that first was an early settler colonialism, separate out, fall off the civilizational scale, right? Ah, we got to civilize. We have to bring them up into a modern form of thought, levy rule, etc. But in the 70s, and this is around the same time that we have this idea of the whole Earth coming out, we also have, and for reasons that I've talked about also, we have this new governing order that's working through this Gianto political framework, life, non-life, but now in a new subtle and kind of cunning way. We recognize cultural difference. We recognize that all cultures contribute to the civilizational expression of the human. You're in Australia, so we recognize you as culturally different. And we base your ability to reclaim your own lands that we took on your ability to show us your cultural difference. But it has to be something that doesn't, and this is by law, it has to be something that doesn't fundamentally challenge common law. So it had to be a difference that, in some ways, made no difference. But it had to be really different so I could feel it. Like, you have these lawyers in land claim and, you know, the public who wanted to feel the difference, but not really be threatened by it. The fact, the best form of this difference was, in fact, for a group to say, here's a creek, here's a rock, here's a sand. This is a thoughtful, intending, responsive entity. And it was perfect for this form of colonialism, which is in the 70s through the present, because it was just, well, that's I mean, just as throwing out. It's like, screw cultural recognition, we don't care anyways. What we really want is access to your land. So it's become a little more bold, which is very at the very moment that this is crumbling. So if you were indigenous in Australia, you always felt this governing through something that was demanding you demonstrate your obligation to this practical idea that is not an idea, it's something that in practice analytically you knew that this creek, that rock, this sandbank, this river, this fog was a co-interpreting entity with you. But at the same time, you also knew, you're telling me to tell you this and explain it to you, gather in a house, explain it to you, go over and over it in detail, so that you can experience me as the safe kind of crazy person, right? And I govern you through it. So it was very interesting little houses back then. So Gianto power was always a leading edge of governance. So part of what we as a film collective, and I'm not sure if everyone was at the talk last night or not, but as a film collective, we've been exploring is exactly that dilemma. That is, what is it to be demanded to express something which is going to then govern you and place you in a certain kind of hierarchy. And that's what the films are trying to explore. Yeah.
Can you give an example of, so you talked about being able to represent that you had a difference without challenging law.
Right.
So
Yeah, there was much.
Right, so there's a decision by the indigenous population to say, like, okay, this is an easy way to show that.
Well, it wasn't. There wasn't a decision. So there's not a some kind of governing pan-indigenous body that right. Rather, through a series of encounters with both the law and public, certain kinds of differences ran people, it was like an analytic. These films are analytics. Presenting yourself in a certain way is an analytic. And by what I mean by that is if you pull out this in this atmosphere, does it turn red or purple, right? If I pull this out in this environment, does the thing in my hand suddenly eat away my hand, right? Or does it suddenly protect it for something? So for instance, if you very quickly, it became very clear if you said, well, you know, part of what, like being the demand is, what is your culture? You'd explain it to us and you say, oh, well, there are a lot of parts and some of it, you know, I'm not quite sure about anymore, and we don't really do it anymore. For instance, it used to be that people could take a kid and marry him when they were 11. Usually it was young girls, but also sometimes young boys, and then you'd start down the path saying they didn't have sex with him, but by the time you even got there, it was just like, oh, no, I'm sorry, that's criminal code. And you were, and people would talk about how they could absolutely feel the register of like disgust just waving over them. It's like, okay, well, don't bring up that part. Was there a decision or was it an analytic? So over the course of these things, it was very much of the way these analytics unfold over time without anybody really making a decision, although there are smaller decisions, like in groups, don't say that, say this. That this idea of does this rock list, do you, so you believe this rock listens and smells you? Yes, so in order for it not to smell people that it doesn't know, we put fire under the arms and you paint up and then it accepts you as. And you could just see the different affective relationship to difference. It was like, oh, that's really weird. We like that. So again, it's this—it's the way in which settler power works, not by, you know, not the old-fashioned way in which you put disease on blankets or you shot up families, but it works in a more insidious way. Insidious way, sorry. Again, someone asked the question about experimentation last night, which is a really great question because it's experiments are analytics. And settler colonialism is experimenting on people in these zones of abandonment. And the people there, and not just people, but all the forms of existence there are experimenting on how to continue in some form, right? A creek is experimenting on how to continue in one form, some form. But it's experimenting in the actual conditions in which the existence are, right? And that's part of the imaginary that happens, which is really like the public, I'm not sure the name of it, is always casting people out into another time. Are you in that other time? Or are you only in our time? And the idea that the rock listens, et cetera, put you in another time, that's great, right? But then you say, what, I'm not in another time and neither is this rock. This rock is in the middle of a sewer pit, just like I am. Yeah, don't. So it's really, these films are analytics. They're trying to, not only as we're making them, test each other about, yeah, okay, well, how do we respond to this? But also, what kind of effects do these things have as they move around the world?
How do you think about technology within that? Because technology seems to be also in a non-time, other time, right? Like
you don't work with technology. We can't even find the right cord. No, but I'm serious. Yeah.
Yesterday you made a comment about being interested in
I was totally asleep yesterday. I totally apologize. I was like on so many different time zones. I had no idea where I was. And then I couldn't see you guys because it was very light. And so you were this wall of darkness. Anyways, what did I say?
when you were talking about the GPS program, one of the things you said was that you liked you and the Karrabing liked the idea that you could walk around with your device and the history or the archive would be you know, also exposed to the elements.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's right.
The archive is, but the archive is actually not.
the archive is way in time. That's what's so interesting. One of the problems that anyone who's a librarian knows, just go off on a tangent, because we really were doing this GPS and it ran into all the bureaucratization of indigenous life. Like, have you signed all that? Then we're just like, oh, screw this. We can't do this. And, you know, anyways, there's a lot more money than I could hemorrhage. So that's where we went to film, because actually it's hemorrhageable since it's in drips and drops. But everybody who works in, say, a library knows one of the biggest problem with the digitalization of everything is that the platform, the actual technological platform and the software that runs it is always getting old. And most, someone had a statistic on this, and I'm gonna say most, which really doesn't tell you anything, but it's a lot of a library budget now goes to upgrading the infrastructure. Because although we like to experience digital everything as outside of time and floating around, not only does it depend on time sensitive changing infrastructure, software, etc., screens, when they become, lose the kind of bridge moment into the other kind of, you're just, it's lost. You have a thing and you can't get it out. Shake, shake, shake.
Yeah, I mean, there is a really great story about the Earthrise photograph. Like,
yeah, that's right.
That with techno-archaeologists.
So yeah, totally. That's fine.
We tend to think about technology as being without time, even though, sure, we know that like our old phone doesn't do the things that it used to do. But yeah. Right, there's like a perception that it is without
right.
Time, space and time.
Right. Right.
Well, I think that there's a simultaneously of time, more than no time. That's what technology brings.
Yeah.
For example, networks like GPS.
Yeah.
To say. Or the internet,
yeah.
It collapses time all in one, then
yeah.
Time zones don't really exist.
Right.
You know, there's a conjunction of all those times. You know, it's just another.
Yeah,
the virtual time is not the real time.
No, but this is gonna seem like a deviation, but I'm gonna deviate and hopefully we'll see how it's not. We were talking about this lunch. Take a fossil. And a cell phone. And the hand that holds a cell phone. Right. It's really hard for us to not see these as in different times. Well, this fossil, like especially if it's, I don't know, it's like one of those, oh, you know, what are those trilobites? Right. Ubiquitous up in upstate. So a trilobite. So you have a rock with a little trilobite on it. You guys know what that is. That's that thing. Yeah. And a hand and a cell phone that maybe I'm going to take a picture and send it to one of my brothers and say, ha, 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 look, because he loves them and I got a best one you don't have. Something like that. It's really hard for us, I think, to say these are in the exact same time. One is not before the other. And what I mean by that is really simple, is that fossil that we find it very hard, Melosu uses this trick to Quintin, who's one of the speculative realists, to trick us into agreeing with him. But it's exactly where he's wrong. It's that thing I'm holding in my hand bears all the imprint of, if you want to say, everything that's happened to it, including me holding it in my hand. Just like my hand bears all the imprint of what came to compose it, which is my hand. We're not in different times, materially. We're in simultaneous times. We're only in one time. There's no other time. Right. When I talk about simultaneity, that's what I mean. Right. So the cell phone, the archive on it that says archive, so we say, oh, it's in a different time. No, it's not. It's nowhere except here. And these things that we sort out by time and then say, well, in the beginning there was no life, and then there was life, and then there was evolutional life, and then we have us and the cell phone, and then we'll have artificial. No, all in the same time. Now you can set the, you can set up a digital archive to emphasize the experience of brought together timeness, right? And that's what the tourist outfits love. Cool, right? Or you can try and emphasize that there is no time other than where we're at. You holding this thing that has all the imprints of where you are and this thing, right? And then this other thing that isn't here anymore. You can try and foreground that. And I, some people in the collective when we were doing this really thought that would be kind of cool to do. Like, you know, maybe make it so your phone actually broke down so that it would disappear at some point. And you'd think, first you'd think it was your phone got like a virus, and then it would be just part of the programming. So I'm not sure if you're...
No, that I'm completely in agreement with the idea of simultaneously, yeah. Instead of the no time, I think it's a togetherness.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. And it's very, you know, it's like before is not here.
Yeah, this is also
before is not here.
Yeah, when I started to talk about the Amazon, everyone was saying, well, it's from another time.
Exactly.
But when you're there, you realize there is no other time. Mm-mm. It's the same time as our time here.
Mm-hmm.
But I was just like, now that you are talking again about archive, then we will look at the film.
Oh,
like
yeah.
Yesterday, it was very interesting when you explained how you work together. So it's sort of collaborative, if I can say so. No one is more important than the other. And there is no written scenario, so scenario develops while you go. But there is, my question is, whom do you address?
Oh, yeah,
is this yourself or, you know, who?
Yeah, yeah, the addressee.
Whom do you make the film?
Yeah. You know, right now, and I'll answer them kind of all, right now we say if we were all sitting together here, which I always feel a little lonely when I start talking about Karrabing and I'm like the only one sitting here. You notice when last night I saw myself doing this hard, I always look over to this empty space, and so this is the empty space, and it's like, okay. But when we're together, we just say Karrabing. So we don't say, and if we're in Toledo, we say Karrabing Film Collective, right? But collaborative is no better either. So really what we say is Karrabing Mob. But that's mob, yeah. Or Karrabing Mibla, which is us people. Mm-hmm. So because it's mainly Creole with some Emmy angle, with two or three, indigenous languages, like languages from there, which Creole is also from there. So it's like Karrabing Mob. And mob is always such a funny word because it has such heavy connotations in like political theory, like the mob. And you know, we kind of know where the etymology came from because I'm sure someone called us indigenous people a mob and you know, whatever. But mob really means, for the closest thing is a collective. It's something that it's heterogeneous. It's individually willful. Like everybody in there is their own little stubborn, willful person, including me. And yet stays together. Why? Why does Karrabing continue to stay together? We ask each other, why do we stay together? And there's really, it's like, well, because we can't be apart. Like, and they say, well, Beth, why do you keep coming back for 31 years? I say, it's a really good question. I tried to stop many times. I really did. No, I did. It's very disruptive. I mean, I've constructed a life around the rhythm of it. But, at some point, I thought, oh, my God, this just disrupts every relationship I ever have. But because I cannot, and that's, we see that as good. We see what a collective is that which individually you cannot help but do. That's what you're trying to make people obligated to each other, right? So if in a crude way we say, well, if I feel like the pressure, I want to be free, and it's like, well, that's not, anyway, so it's a collective in that sense. There's no written, I mean, I've typed up stuff because, you know, sometimes we like to have meetings which we have paper passed along and they say, type up what we're doing, I type it up, and then we pass around, everybody puts it in their pocket because we talk through everything. And someone will propose, like the when people are saying, are we gonna make another movie? Everyone's saying, we're gonna make another movie, and we're all like, we don't know. I mean, the first one was so exhausting. And then I said, well, who does anyone want to make a movie? And the younger guy said, hey, we want to make a movie about beer and policing. And then everyone was like, okay, but this and that and the other thing added into it. And then we shape it into a story. Everyone kind of assigns themselves the roles they want to play. Some people say, I don't want to act, I just want to be location. We now know what a location scout is, so I want to be location scout. This new one, a lot of people wanted to be the camera person. It's like, okay. And there's not really like, are you good at it? But over time, you know, it's kind of sorts itself out. There's one person that's really good at actually finding the right play. We all know this land like the back of our head, but she's just really amazing about going there. And it's like, oh, that's perfect. That's right. So, and if someone does want to do it, they don't do it. And then the story, we start going, and the story, if it deviates, it deviates, and then kind of comes back again. And then we edit it up, and then go back and forth editing it. So it works the way we work as a group. That is, if we want to go, a Karrabing wants to go out and do something, it's like there's like someone wants to go get a cow, so shoot a cow. Someone wants to go get turtles, someone wants to go shopping, someone wants to do, and we end up doing something, right? But it's very much Pierre de Castro, Society Against the State. Do you guys know that book? It really is. It's like no one wants to be responsible for having made the decision because then you're obligated for whatever happened. It's a non-leader, willfully individual, stubborn group that finds itself continually obligated to each other. And that's all that it is. And when it stops being that, it won't exist, which is kind of fantastic. The address of the film's really interesting. At first, you know, it was just someone said, well, we just should tell our story, because everyone was in this bind, no one was listening, they were kind of homeless, not kind of, very homeless. And they were just like, we're just gonna tell our own story. I was like, okay, let's do that. But the idea of who was gonna watch this thing, it was never really, it was like, we're gonna tell our own story, so we tell our own story. And no one ever said, to whom?
To yourself, no? Maybe.
No, there was some idea that we're telling our story to those people that don't have a clue about what it's really like to be indigenous, who still fantasize or denigrate us. We're gonna tell them our story. But it didn't have any bigger shape than, I'm not a director, I was an academic, so I am an academic. So, you know, circuits of the circulation through various kinds of venues, television, film festivals, art galleries, etc. This is not something I quite understood or knew yet. None of us did. But again, it's us. It's like, it didn't matter. We wanted to tell a little story, so then we're doing it because that's what everybody thought we should do, and so we did it. When it started moving, then it became interesting. Definitely they didn't want people in the community to see it because they thought people would make fun of them acting, which was truly interesting. They said, well, don't, and it was like, well, okay, but are we just making these things and then putting them in the shelf? And then that got talked about, and then they were like, and then the group kind of came to the idea that showed elsewhere. And then they saw that people actually thought it, they said, oh, well, that's good, that's right. And then it was like, we are good at what we do. And when we showed it at the Gertrude Contemporary, which is kind of like a, it's an art critical space, they asked us, why are you showing it in a critical art space? Why aren't you showing it at a film festival? And people then who were there said, because you asked us here. So there's a certain kind of, again, experimental
audience.
Yeah, and not overly worried about when we're making the films. You know, it's not like, oh, we should, it's just, you know, it's kind of great. It's just this idea, well, it can just go anywhere. Anywhere it can go, and then it would begin wherever it goes. If we can get there, we can get there. So it's a very, so that, you know, want to be seen, but not worried about, you know, and I say, oh, okay, well, you know, I'm bring someone to talk to us about distribution or people who could give us money to make films that like normal TV would watch, and then we meet the people and what they say we have to do, people just like, no, we don't really want to do that. Then we have a discussion, like, because, you know, you have to have a script, you have to be on a certain kind of production schedule, and it's like, nah. So there are decisions that are made, but, and again, it's very imminent, and at the same time, like, they want to have a little, they want a story, they want, it's experimental, I'm not sure, the making is very experimental, but I'm not sure if the product is, I would call it experimental, in the sense that when I think of experimental film, what I see is very different than what we did. They want it to be something that tells a little story. Do you guys want to see one of them? Yeah.
Yeah, so we have the...
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
Well, let me just mention one quick thing. So whenever you're ready,
We're going to have a vote about which one to see.
This should be set up. Okay. It's just they didn't know which drive it was on, so
yeah,
we just have to reconnect it.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't even know what drive is.
Whenever you're ready.
Yeah.
All right. I have a question about the language.
Oh, yeah.
Some of them were in English. Some kids to show were in English, but some were not.
Yeah.
And how was the negotiation?
That's also... so when we started doing this, the question is, and the literacy level is, you know, its literacy level is, would be similar to many impoverished, structurally racialized spaces. So reading a script is just, it's just goofy. I mean, it's just not very something that makes any sense there. And people are really good. I wish I could show you one that's close. I'll give you an example. But first I'll do this. So the question is like language we're supposed to speak. And the local language is a form of Creole in which I don't know. Which has registers. So it can come up to what you would understand as English, and then it can go into some things that you would say syntactically and lexically is not English. So, you might sit down, me I've been come in, but I've been standing up front, and I've been talk, low. I don't know if you can understand that or not. Yeah, right? So it's like talk pigeon or something like that. So the decision was made that just rip out whatever you feel comfortable with. And depending on who they're playing, like if they're playing the government housing inspector, they go up to what they experience is how white people talk, right? But for the most part, it's interesting, the language has stayed at the kind of more to the English, but the idea is just better to just act like a normal human being and let it rip, and we're gonna subtitle everybody. White people speaking English, indigenous people speaking Creole, indigenous speakers, everyone's getting subtitled. Because Australians, I can't understand, and Scottish people, have you ever tried to understand what a Scots sound? I can't understand a word they're saying. So I don't know, so if we just subtitle it all. And that way, instead of obsessed about what's coming out of your mouth, you can more fully inhabit whatever the person that you're portraying yourself as. Because you're portraying some aspect of either yourself or another kind of person you're really familiar with, like housing inspectors, legal aid. Like, you know how these people act, you have studied them, right? There's something else I was gonna say, I can't remember. Any question? So they're both, and I have to warn you, they're both like 34 minutes. Okay, so I don't think we should do both, and here's the option, and then we're gonna vote. One of them is more solidly within this, the way in which local life is governed by those who understand that some things have sentience and some things do not, i.e. living and non-living. And it's when the dogs talked. So it's the one with the kids at the hole. The more recent one is more about toxicity landscape and who goes to jail for what kind of stealing. So it's more in that register. First one? Yeah, I think the first one.
Yeah.
Oh, I know what I was going to say, and then we'll shut it. In terms of language thing, I am director, and I have my own trick. We all have tricks. Like, we're very good at having our little trick, because you have to have little tricks. You sit on top of each other, and everyone has nothing, and so you're always, like, trying to trick the other person into giving you something they don't want to give you. Okay. You got to be tricky. So director got her little trick too in this domain. So one of my little tricks was in the new film we're doing, there really was a fine of $20,000 for setting off this flare. And we overcrowd everything. And like this boat, there were like supposed to be four people on it, and there were like 10. There are no, what are those things where you float? Yeah, life jacket. Paddle. There was one time we were cruising back from somewhere, and oh my God, we were here and the shore was up there, and there were crocodiles all over the place. And we ran out of petrol, and the tide was going out, and so it was going the wrong way, and we were like, we didn't have paddle or anything. And we were like, someone had this great idea, we'd take an anchor and we'll throw it out, and then we'll drag ourselves and throw it out and drag ourselves to the shore. And someone said, why don't you just, Beth, you swim, you jump out, and just swim us to shore. I was like, I am not coming out of here half, which is what we say, you come out half, because the bottom half is eaten. And I was like, I'm not doing it. Here, I'll throw the anchor a couple of times, I said. I throw the anchor a couple of times. And then one of the guys decided it was his turn to throw the anchor. So he got up and he threw the anchor and the boat tipped over and he landed in the water and we were like, oh, you're gonna come out of half. And then he stood up because the water was already back. Anyways, so we're very bad. And this one time was very bad because I was gonna have to pay that $20,000 because I didn't own the boat. And so the people who technically owned the boat were gonna like $20,000. We were like, oh my God. We got it reduced down to 2,000, which is great. We paid it off. But so my trick in the film was when the papers arrive, like the office brings papers and say you're gonna have to fill out these forms if you don't want to get the $20,000 fine. We like to make it, actually we think we have real humor in some of these films. So I thought, oh, okay, how am I gonna get people, like throw them off their stride? So inside these forms, I started, had a bunch of, please answer the following questions. And then I said, were you, and I put the Latin. Were you, I forget what the Latin, I had all these Latin terms, legal terms, when the incident happened. But I didn't tell him, so I gave it to one of my sisters, Moonville. And so she opened up, and she was like, because they knew they were supposed to open it up and read, and we knew the scene. So she opened up, she says, were you, what? And then she looks at me, and she says, what is this? I said, you have to read it. She's trying to read it. And then another sister says, Beth, what is this? And I said it, because I can't remember what it was, and I said it, what it was, and she said, oh, okay. So she, in the scene, she walks over to her sister, and she says, it says, were you, and then she just rips through that Latin like there's no tomorrow, because language is something that we're, they are in particular, less so me, trained to be, because there's so many languages in the area. So language facility is really something people are very gifted at, because of, it's not bilingual, it's multilingual, you know. And that was just this beautiful example. I was like, I couldn't rip that off just hearing it once. And she was just on spot about whatever it was, omni, exodus, philidios, I don't know what it was.
Yeah, I'm Gene Moreno.
Yeah.
I'm Gene Moreno.
You also get it. Yes.
Are you with education? Or visitor services? Okay, all right, nice to meet you. missed a couple of people up here. Great, I think we're ready. This is Denise, who's saving our lives. We're ready to go, and again, if anybody would like a really prime seat, they're right up here.
Yeah, and I can do that thing that all people make films do when they start showing them the notes.
Gigi.
Give over at least a lot of people.
bored by now. Can you even miss a car?
Anybody can help?
Ah, you got it here, yeah.
Well, are we really at the Friday, you know? It's the last day.
You're not ready, you're here, right? Okay.
Give me a film of these with a busy car.
What do you want to go for a ride? Kids want to go for a ride.
I'm going to go for a ride. You're one Friday, you know? any more light in that dish that hit it.
and I don't agree with this. I don't. And you let that thing happen at the same time, and yet, you better worry about my sister back to God.
Yeah, yeah, worry about it again, or I'll get it on the burning.
Yeah, I think I'm going to make me laugh. I'm going to be a ha. Oh my god. Thank you.
or what for machine.
Although this is an object that you watch, and that's part of what Karrabing wants to happen, this was made. And one of the things that, and I didn't say this last night, but one of the things that making these things does is that it gets everyone, especially the younger kids, to be in these places. And there's a little scene about the sweat, like, why do I have to be here, the sweat. And as they're acting, actually sweating 100. So you're in the representational act, you are pragmatically continuing what, at least in an argumentative space, some people say is absolutely fundamental to keeping this dog drinking in place. It doesn't matter that there's an argument. The argument actually keeps it vital. It's like, was it a machine? Was it a dog? Was it this? Was it that? As long as it's something that people care enough about to argue, it's still there. Right? And so it's hard. There was a great question yesterday. It's like, it's so much about making the group make the thing, make the places and each other still vital, and vital enough so that if someone comes and says, hey, you know what? There's a great magnesium mine under this dog hill. What do you say we mine it? That in the act of having made this thing that circulates, a group says, no, actually, I sweat in there. I know that place. Right? And that's really what the filming is for, as well as a thing that circulates in the tricep effect at a distance. The second thing to say is that as a text object that is made within certain kinds of textual practices. It, and this was the first part of the film was a short that showed at the Berlinale, and then we finished it because everyone said it had to be finished. And the first thing I made with Liza Johnson, who's a filmmaker, we didn't know how to make films. I didn't know how to make film. So, and she's a filmmaker, so if you look at the credits, this one goes, what is it? Produced and co-produced. No, it doesn't say directed. No, no, but the first one says, the written and performed by, scripted and performed by, something like that. That's right, friend. And then there's a thing, and then it says directed by, right? And then it's credits. Well, in many ways, that was because Lies is actually a professional filmmaker. It's like, you know, how do you organize that kind of, because it's real work, and she did this thing to talk about films. The next film, but it also pulls me out in this way. That's really kind of weird. So this next, the next one we did, the credits actually are really, I think, much better and organized. We don't have to worry about anyone whose profession is filmmaker. Like, it doesn't really matter, professionally or not. You know, it's fine. It's not something that I need or so. So the next one goes conceived and performed by the Karrabing Film Collective. There's a little code. And then there's a list of credits.
Everyone, turn off your cell phones.
There's a list of credits. No, sorry. Then there's the actors. Then there's the crew, including the director of China, and everybody. And then there's a Karrabing Collective film members are. There's a group of people who are in the collective, and then the usual thing. So it's I think it's better foregrounds that this is like a collective effort, and then it differentiates according to what everybody does, and everybody says we should all be listed as what we did. But it levels the roles. So it's been, you know, so that's also interesting, just as the text sort of things.
Yeah. Yesterday you were talking about Karrabing, like a sort of society standing still.
Yeah.
And then I remember my experience last year in South Africa or in Belgrade in Serbia, where people have very this strange relationship to the government, to the state, and they are like standing still, but there is no dialogue.
Right.
They also maybe don't want to make a dialogue.
Right.
They're standing still. Can you talk a little bit about, you said that actually filmmaking is making them
move. Action, yeah. So and it's really important that two things, if I don't complete the thought, then you wind up in a place you don't want to wind up in. So the first, the overarching problem that the Karrabing face and a lot of places that are poor, racialized, colonized face is twofold. The way in which any distributions of goods are provided through the state is based on its compatibility with capital. So yesterday when I talked about the descent group, it's most compatible with capital and least compatible with an understanding of belonging to land on the basis of what they were saying, which is visiting, knowing, interacting with. So the way in which the state provides, even when it's being good, provides resources, is not based on any need to interact with anything. You're just in the group based on where you're born or you're not. So there's no need to do anything. Right. Now, whether intended or not, whether the state is evil and figured this out in the beginning, which it probably was and probably thought it was doing a good thing, what that does is it creates a situation in which people have no relation to place often because they're a long way away, and as the film shows, I mean, you have to have a lot of resources to get to some of these places. You know, you have to have a car, you have to have a boat, and those cost a lot of money. And then you have to have the petrol to run it, and upkeep it, et cetera. So these are, a lot of the spaces are, and these lands are very abstract. It's like, you know, Bonacoulay, we never know, where is it? You know, it's a very abstract thing. So someone comes up and says, hey, you're poor shit, because we've made you so. Would you like $20,000 for mining your country? Or it's usually at a mining your country, well, it's an abstraction. You don't know how big the country is, you don't know what mine looks like, so yeah, right? And what they and me too together surmise is that once you establish this ongoing relationship, it's like any other
something wrong with it. It gives me up to you, you know, I feel the obligation.
Mm-hmm. It's a community, it's a family. You talk
the place, yeah, the place, the whole place is, right? You smell it, you feel it, remember when you remember that experience, you're being with it. That's how, okay. So, A, the question is, God, what can get people to go there? And we tried different things, and filmmaking actually really works. So the kids want to be in films. It's like, fantastic. Then we'll do it through films. You want to be on the big screen? We're going to this country. You know, so it's one of the ways to make it up. Now, the trouble is that a neoliberal government who wanted to roll back land rights, even the way I criticize it, nevertheless, they wanted to roll it back and say, we need to get rid of land rights because, and welfare, because it's made people unmotivated to get jobs. So we're going to take away welfare, and we're going to open up lands for development. So that's their answer. The neoliberal state says our answer is just to withdraw everything, and that'll get you up. But once again, it in no ways tries to support this other way of creating an obligation to place. It continues to try to undermine it. So the Karrabing have to both say, in some ways, no to the way the state understands our relation to land, at the same time saying no. We don't agree with you that our land is nothing but a commodifiable substance through which we can enter into enterprise capitalist society. So it's kind of being trying to figure out a way of staying no to both of them. Because that's what we see also in Eastern Europe. It's like, well, we got to get rid of the welfare state, but the replacement is every dog for himself. Yeah. And can there be a way in which all the dogs, including that rock dog, can go forward together? I don't know. Do we want to chat or be done?
Any other questions?
I have a curious question.
Yeah.
What's up with that fire?
Oh. Well, okay. Remember last night when I told the story about, for those who are there, how Cameron, who decided last minute he didn't want to be a gang member, he wanted to be a ranger, yeah. Right? And which was really, because it's like on that hill, he just, let me say what happened on the hill and then I'll say, remind you of Cameron, then I'll explain the fire. So what happened on the hill was all those kids, there had been a land claim, and that hill, we all knew there was a dog dreaming there. We had all been told that, everybody knew. And we also knew that dog dreamer was related to the lane mob, which he says the robin mob. But see that fence,
mm-hmm.
Right? That's on this pasture land, which is some guy owns that place. And the people who owned it first would shoot you. So we'd never gone there. They hadn't gone, I hadn't gone, no one had gone there. And then there's the land claim. And the land commissioner, and the land claims are supposedly good, you know, if you're traditional, right people, you get your land back. Well, he said, okay, so your dog people, your dog clan, where's your dreaming? And they said, at Budget, which is the name of this area. And he said, where? And they were like, he said, you never been there? And they were like, and then they turned to me and they said, where, pointed on the map, where is the bath? And I was like, it's behind the swamp. Because I was the, you know. And then he went, you don't know where your dreaming is? You don't get the country. And at that point, it was like, okay, we're cutting into this country. So we snuck under the fence. And over the course of time, we took each one of those kids there, either together or not. So we went to shoot, and they all said the version of what they said the first time they saw these holes. They were like, okay, well, wait a minute, what really made these holes? Because they're really kind of, like when you go up there and you know the story and then you see the holes, they're really amazing. It's like this totally smooth in the middle and raggedy on the outside. It looks exactly like, you know, they had been drilled by an enormous creature of sticks. And, you know, they like, you're like, auntie, what made this hole? I said, I don't know. Okay, and then they all came, well, it must have been this, must have been that. So when we went to filming, everyone decided those kids had to say, in the beginning, then we just let the camera run. And after they each took their turn, they were like, and we were like, which we now knew, and just keep going. So they just kept going until they got a real fight. And we hadn't said anything more than each one of you had to say something, and they got a real fight, and emotions happened, right? Which was part of what the film was about. Okay. Now, so that was great, but this one especially was like, okay, we're going, and different people decided different things. Like Gigi decided, well, wait a minute. I walked away, and we're like, yeah, you walked away from your house. Okay, so what did I fly down here? And everyone said, oh, you're the mystery person. And at some point, I said, you're gonna follow them and always be playing tricks on them. And then someone said, yeah, and you'll light the fire to like punish us for not going back and trying to save your house. But then, more Jesus said, I'm not doing that. So then her daughter had to light the fire, and then with the editing process, it all got a little kabooly. So the short of it is, in Australia, if you're an Australian, you know that in the north, we light fires, people light fires. And part of the way in which you express ownership of the place is making fires is a great thing. Well, the grass is really dry. So if you do it right, it's called kerosene. And the trees don't actually burn down because it just goes so fast that the winds are up. So everyone lights fires, and indeed, this pastoral stage, fire, and, you know, fires don't care about that fence. It just burned down, burned away, often it's burned. And this guy, when we're making it now, he had a big hay field. And burned through his hay field. It was really bad. It's terrible. But anyways, that was also like, do you want to come down here? Can't believe we did it. So it's in the film, depending on where you are, you know what it indicates. So it's also this kind of sensitivity to film context and interpretation. So it's interesting.
Did they win their landing?
No. No, they totally lost. But that's okay, because that's part of, you know, part of my role. As I was assigned to be an anthropologist when I was, you know, after I was first there. And so part of my assignment is to, you know, go in and mop up by, and one of the great things about being somewhat big in my profession is it has a sort of kind of heft, so that afterwards it was like, and I felt bad. I thought, fuck, I should have known that we would have to know, we should have said everybody, and you know, we weren't Karrabing when the land thing happened, but we were ourselves, and we would have just busted into that place and found it. But I didn't do it, I was coming and going. So anyways, I just felt guilty, and I was like, screw this. So we busted in and got the documentation and everything, and we just went to the land council and we said, irrespective of what happened with the judge, we want to put, and there's a way in which you can get around it. So if the lease ever comes up, they're all protected. But it's a very, yeah, it's still very rough out there. There are people that will shoot you, and you know. But then again, we steal their cows and their grass.
Do you help them find lawyers when they need lawyers?
Oh, you know what's great? This wasn't on when I said that.
I took it and I turned it on. Do we? Yeah, no, that's right. Oh, no, it's a very, you know, like once. One of the young guys was it was a grandson of mine and a nephew of mine, and they were all living in that house, and it was overcrowded, and you know, there's a lot of what you would probably call substance abuse, and there's a lot of fighting, there's a lot of everything. So anyways, there was some big bust out and the cops came. And they just started giving warrants, and it's like Ferguson, in which fines, like slow cut by fines. Right? Like if you're at one of the communities and a cop catches you with a beer in your hand, because it's $150. If you make $10,000 a year, two beers, $360. I mean, that's 2 weeks' pay, if you fill out all the forms all the time. So anyway, it's one of these things, and they filled out this, they put DVIs on the two guys who call each other brother, and they live in the same house, there's nowhere else to live. And DVI is like, you can't be next to each other, or near each other. So, and if they caught him being next to each other, they'd get fined, you know, the whole thing would go. So then Gavin had to show up in court, and I was flying back, so I flew back, and they said, oh, Beth, Gavin's at court, and I said, oh, well, let's go, we'll go. So his stepmom, the two young guys, me, over, who's, I just want to go out bush, stay out bush. He's married to Gigi. We all go to court, and we're sitting in the courthouse, and this is Darwin. And his name is on the board, and we're waiting, because usually legal aid comes and helps you, but legal is not coming, it's not coming, it's not coming. So we go over and we say, oh, you know, we're here. And they said, oh, let's look at your thing. Oh, DVI, no, they passed a law that we can't help with DVIs. So if it's domestic violence, you're on your own, new law. So we're like, okay, well, just tell us how this works. He's like, oh, well, you should have gone into that courtroom and just waited in line and tried to get your, because if we don't do it, he's gonna get a fine for not having to go to court. So we go in there and we're just studying what's going on, and we study the police go up to the desk, a lawyer goes up to the desk, they shuffle papers, the prosecutor's there, they say, we wanna present this case. The guy says, okay, is so-and-so in the room, so-and-so in the room, what do you plead, blah, blah, blah. This goes, and nobody's left in this room except us. And they're about to close up and leave. And so I run up to somebody and I say, oh, can we do our case? And she says, yeah. And, because we had had it figured out. I'm gonna be the lawyer. They've studied how to do it. And I wasn't playing, so I had, like, you know, and we just have t-shirts and shorts on and flip-flops. So I go up and I say, okay. And we know how to mock people, not mock, but play, like, you know, those are not actual housing inspectors. So, you know, Your Honor, I'd like to apologize for my clothes. You know, so it's just like, and then they get up and they do the thing. And it was really, I mean, it all worked out great. He thought it was a joke too. But it's not a joke, because if we, you know, all those little things, it's just, it is like the racialization of fines in this country. If this happened to happen and that happened to happen, there would have been a fine. He wouldn't have paid the fine. He would have been in jail. You're in jail. Da 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 da. Yeah, it's all these little things. It's the car breaking down. It's the fence.
The flare. Like,
who would have thought a flare? I didn't know a flare. You know.
You're supposed to save your life. Yeah.
No. Don't let off a flare. As a matter of fact, I was talking to. We had to rent a boat to when we're making the new movie to shoot some scenes, and I was talking to the boat guy who we're renting from, and I said, so you know about all these rules and regulations. Like, if we got a flare and we just set it off, like, on the land, because we wanted to, like, shoot it, would we get in trouble? He said, I would suggest to you that you never set off a flare anywhere. I was like, okay, we'll use the firecracker. I don't know, you know, like, the old-fashioned science fiction movies where that you have the spaceship on a stick going through space. We'll do it with a firecracker as a flare. So it's and really trying to not make it dramatic, that the way in which this power works in these liberal contexts, settler contexts, is all these slow things in which you just say, oh, fuck it, I give up, I'm not doing this. It's just not worth the effort. And that's how power works. It's not worth the effort. Why even try? Why do anything? You know.
It seems like there's a lot of walking, like back and forth.
Which is the lie part of the story. There's no walking. Yeah, no, there's walking. Exactly. When this happened, when this film was being shot, Australia, from saying, oh, we recognize the worth of the cultural other, as long as the cultural other is this form of difference that really doesn't challenge us whatsoever, to cultural difference causes child sexual abuse. And it was like that. You guys need to get out. We're going to withdraw all the funding from these small rural communities and remote communities, and you all have to get into the city and just get a job like everyone else. But they don't say there's no housing in the cities. So someone, either you get no housing in the rural communities, so you go to the city, there's no housing, or one person like Gigi has a house, so everybody crowds in, because if not, you're living in the long grass. Everyone crowds in, the housing inspector comes, says, you're violating your lease. Boom, now you're all gone again, mm-hmm. Right?
That's what happens when she left in the morning.
Yeah, her story is like, I can't take the stress anymore, which is true. So that's why she takes off. I can't stand the stress anymore.
Stay with the house.
Well, I just don't give a shit. And, you know, and Over's like, I can't take the stress anymore.
So the government doesn't have any programs in terms of counseling, education? They're just
They have a lot of programs. But, you know, so does America. But it's like a lot of programs. The real question is, does anyone really care if it works? And the answer is no. No, nobody cares. Does anyone really care whether programs to pull the structurally poor out of poverty, whether in various ways it's racialized in the US? No, but there's a lot of programs. So what are the programs for? Now, again, I don't think it's evilly intentioned except for some people, but I don't think it helps to really understand what's at stake to think of it as evil intention. Instead, the good intention allows people to say that, see, they're trying. Mm-hmm. So it's a mechanism for shifting accountability. Mm-hmm. And it's no different. So, and indeed, one of the things that I think all of the films, but this one does really well, is go, these are people who keep going, and yet, there's nowhere to go. You just kind of shuttle back and forth, and the more you shuttle back and forth, the more everything is breaking down, because of course there's no money to keep it up, and you can't be in one place and you can't be in the other place.
So they live very nomadic life, they constantly move and
talk. Nomadic is it's more like
how to survive the next day.
How do you keep things in place as there's nothing in place to support you doing that, mm-hmm. other than, in some ways, your own willfulness. Someone once asked me, like, Beth, you're always, because I'm not for hope, I think it's a liberal sentiment. That's my little problem. But they said, well, if you're not hopeful, and are they hopeful? And I was like, they? No. And then they said, well, why do all of you then keep doing this stuff if it's not hope? And I was like, that's really an interesting question. Some kind of like, I don't know, seminar. So I was sitting there, I was thinking, I said, well, you mean the affect? The affect, what's the affect? And they said, yeah, what's the affect? And I said, I'm gonna wager it's willfulness or stubbornness that we all share. And that's what it's like, I don't give a shit, I'm not stopping. So then I went back, and I was going back anyways, and I sat down. No, that was Gigi, I think, at first, and I sat down and I said, hey, you know what, I was at this place and they asked me this question, so I want to see what your answer is, so that you like hope. She was like, what hope, there's no hope. I said, no, there's no hope, right? She's like, no. I said, so why do we always do things? She was like, tell the truth, Mom, I think you're just very stubborn. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and again, the question then is, how do you build willful things? You know, how do you build willful things? And, you know, you don't build them in ways that you might think is the nicest way of building a willful thing.
Yeah,
and that we also share, yeah, I must say. Without,
it's a resistance.
It's a real, like, fuck you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
massively.
In our class, we've been talking a lot about permaculture and
permaculture, yeah.
Tenets of permaculture is that the border, the boundary, is like the most fertile space. Mm. It's like, it seems very similar, right? That the liminal spaces of not, you know, not belonging allows there to be this kind of fertile intellectual pursuit.
You know, yes, but I really, I actually write about this in this, the not the book coming out, but the last one. I feel that we need to be, like in this room, very, very cautious when we say things like that, because there are a lot of people at Bill Ewan, at Wadai, at Nungia. I can give thousands of communities. And there are lots of people. Mm-hmm. And many, many, many are not fertile.
Yeah, I guess
so it's really interesting to everybody and to this group in particular. Is there a way in which we can say why there are some? And more pertinent to the actual people, why it's so-and-so and not so-and-so, because both of them are related to you, both of them you love, and yet this one is just flat, and this one isn't. And if there was some formula someone could devise and figure out, in a hot second, we would be applying. We'd brew it up in a little vial and you would make everyone drink it. And social theory is like this. It's like someone in these zones, something will be fertile.
Well, how is that any different from the opposite side of saying that, like, liberals are not evil when they're in acting?
Some of them are.
You know what I mean? Like,
some of them.
Like, even whether or not they perceive themselves as that.
Totally. Yeah, no, it's not for me. It's very much that we have to get past this perception, like cannot catch. But the fertile thing is a good question. There's in some ways here's the place in which you might as well try something because nothing, your choices are like nothing, or try something, and it's more interesting. At least what everybody says is the kind of. Well, it's more interesting doing something than doing nothing. And it almost has to stay, if we're really gonna take seriously the political form in these kind of spaces, that's the political form.
But also they are creating a sort of community space, and we were just talking also in the class that the ownership wiped up the idea of the commons in 18th century.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's interesting that they are like, talking about fertility of these border spaces, if this is a border space, the idea of the commons is preserved there, so it's very important for everyone.
Yeah, yeah, with everyone's very defined differences.
Yeah.
You know, so, and that's part of also what is inevitable in this film practice, because everyone's going to put their position in there. And so it's not, which is fantastic, because there's presuppositional space everybody shares, but there's not an agreement, right? Mm-hmm. It's a fertile argumentative space. Mm-hmm. And that's what's really fantastic about it. Well, here people are doing something other than sleeping all day and drinking all day.
Mm-hmm.
That's where this is. That's huge. I mean, it's like massive. And that little, what we would call a low standard, through this has been incredible. So, I mean, if you, there are other people who want to, like, can you, well, it's the usual quantifying success of experiment. And we say, well, you can easily look at this person, like, I mean, it's like in the body. It's like, oh, authorship in this more existential way. But then there are other things, like some of the kids are staying in school. People have the kind of jobs they want to have. Like, well, I actually want to be a ranger, so rather than simply do this, I'm going to try and do that, which, you know, they wouldn't necessarily have done before just because of the constant, like, no, you can't do anything. So there are things in which if there was some kind of person who needed quantitative something, you could do it. But really what it is that...
agency.
Yeah, something that, yeah. So it's, and again, it's a little weird to say that, but that's, yeah, it's like... And it does sound little, but it's so huge. We conceived of something, we did it, and it happened. In the outstation, you know that house? You see there's a little house they lean against. In the background, there's a big tin house. We totally, everybody was homeless, we started making shelters. And that tin house is about as big as this. And we're sitting and we put a floor in it. And I was standing in there with, the young guy who says, his brother, what's wrong with you guys? When they all say hide, hide, and he said, I'm sick of hiding, I don't want to hide anymore. Yeah, I know, that just came out of, that was just like, wow, you know, wow. Because again, it's not scripted, it's just like you guys, like they want to hide and you don't want to, or something like that. We were standing inside this building and Didier and I were standing there, and his little nephew, and I said, and it's tin. It's like a shed, a big shed, but it has windows. We put windows in it. And I said, Didier, what do you think? I said, shed or house? And he was standing there, and he said, it's got windows, it's got a door. I say house. I said, yeah, I say house, it's got a floor. And he said, yes, house, it's house. I said, yeah, I think it's house. I said, do you know anybody else? Because we really, it was a kit, which I thought meant it was already cut, you just like, I thought it was like a kit, but no. It was like not a kit. We were supposed to cut this thing, and then they had an architectural design that was this small, and we were like, what? So we had to just look at it all and try and get it, figure out how to get it together, which we did. It was fantastic. But I said, do you know anybody who just figured out how to put a house like this, just themselves, like a little group? He said, tell you the truth, I haven't seen Aboriginal group. Oh, and I said, and we made a movie. He said, I haven't seen an Aboriginal group do anything himself. Now, that sounds horrendous, and it's not true, but it is registering something about, and he was about 14 at the time, his perception of what settler colonialism had constituted as the world of potential agency that he had. So that little thing is, you can't get anywhere until you bridge that gap. And that's what people are trying to do, and that's what they are doing, and that's what they see themselves doing. Then after that gap, you know, it's kind of like, who knows what could possibly happen. But that from zero to one is much bigger than one to any other number you can imagine. Yeah. And that's what they're doing. And it's really kind of, you know, everybody together, but everybody together. It's an amazing thing. Yeah.
Yeah, well, thank you.
You're welcome. Yay. Thank you guys for coming. And thank you. Oh, thank you for the house.